All right, admin of code day 21. What's happening? Artificial gravity, droid, IntCode, of course. 15 instructions. We have to write a program in our VM. Okay, sure. Seems hard. Okay. I think I have not quite grasped the problem yet. See. So I guess jumping takes you three spaces ahead. And we have the inputs A, B, C, D. Okay. Interesting. plot a safe course. Day went well. This was kind of cool, very confusing. So what was going on here? So we need to write a program inside of our program, I guess. Or I don't know, whatever. We're submitting our solution in some weird programming language to this interactive grader that's written in IntCode, is the way I would put it. So in part one, we are given sort of information about the next four upcoming tiles, and we need to decide when to jump, and whenever we jump four spaces. So my idea for part one is that you should, when should you jump? You should jump if there is an obstacle in any of the three spaces ahead of you, and the fourth space ahead of you is clear. So that is, you might want to jump if A is false, or if B is false, or if C is false, and also D is true. So why is that correct? So there's never, well, I mean, it's sort of not correct as we saw in part two, but I guess the idea is, you know, if there's some obstacle that you can see that you can safely skip, then go ahead and skip it. I guess sort of the implicit promise being made is that if you get to the end of what you can currently see, then it's safe. So obviously, it needs to be the case that D is true to jump, because otherwise you're jumping into a pit. And there's no reason to jump unless A, B, or C is false. And if you can jump over an obstacle, you might as well, is I guess the idea. So for part two, all of that is still true, but now you get a little bit more look ahead. And they actually ask you to use this look ahead. So, right, the key thing that happens in part two is they give a counterexample to that rule that I just described, which is that they make you, right, so they give you this counterexample. They sort of induce you to jump onto this this square by, you know, having an obstacle before it. And then you realize that you're dead, because if you jump, you land here, and if you don't jump, you land here. So you need to use the additional look ahead they gave you. So how can we think about this? So the way I thought about it is that, so, you know, suppose that you're gonna, if you're gonna jump now, you're gonna land at D. Suppose that you did land at D, then how would you get out of this range that we can see right now? So getting out means to getting to either F, G, H, or I, because at that point, you know, we could jump to a currently unseen square. And I guess that's the assumption that we're making is that we win if that happens. So how could we get to F, G, H, or I? So there's three ways. One way is that we could jump immediately again, so that would be just to H. Another way is that we could walk to E and then jump to I. Another way is that we could just walk to F. There's no real way to get to G, right? Because if we walk to F, we're already done, and we can't, you know, jump to G. So that G doesn't matter. So what we should check is that if D is true, and also either H is true, or EI is true, or EF is true. You can parse that, right? So what did I say? I said we want one of DH, DEI, and DEF. Those are the three safe paths through here, we said. So that amounts to D and H or EI or EF, which we can further break down as D and H or E and I or F. Right? So that is what we're actually ultimately going to compute. So first you put T equals I by using a not instruction twice. And then we OR it with F, so now we have T is I or F, and then we AND it with E, so now we have E is, T is E AND I or F. Now we OR it with H, so now we have this, and, well, we actually already put the D into J in part one, so now we just have this thing, and that's what we want to AND with J. And so this expresses that there's some obstacle in the next coming up, the next three squares, just like we did in part one, and also that we can see a safe path to the end of the current vision. And so that gives us our answer, which we can just put in and solve the problem. So that's day 21. Very different problem, kind of cool. I wish they'd explained. Like, I don't think that they ever said that this thing jumps four spaces, but I guess it's sort of implicit in the examples in the output. But yeah, anyway, really, really creative, really different. Cool day. It's day 21.